Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Let us pray. Assist us mercifully with your help, O Lord God of our salvation, that we may enter with joy upon the contemplation of those mighty acts whereby you have given us life and immortality through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany, near the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tethered there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this: 'The Lord needs it, and we'll send it back here immediately.'" They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. And people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he looked at everything as it was laid, he went off to Bethany with the 12. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
Lift your crowns up high. It is right to praise you, Almighty God, for the acts of love by which you have redeemed us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. On this day, he entered the holy city of Jerusalem in triumph and was proclaimed as King of Kings by those who spread their garments and branches of palm along his way. Let these branches be for us signs of his victory. And grant that we who bear them in his name may ever hail him as our King and follow him in the way that leads to eternal life, who lives and reigns in glory with you and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Thank you.
Let us go forth in peace in the name of Christ.
In the name of Christ, amen.
Amen.
Grant that we, walking in the way of the cross, may find it none other than the way of life and peace through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Bless the Lord who forgives all our sins.
God's mercy endures forever.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open and I have all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Jesus said, the first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness by the power of the Holy Spirit. Keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Lesson is from Isaiah. Declare and present your case. Let them take counsel together. Who told this long ago? Who declared it of old? Was it not I, the Lord? There is no other God besides me, a righteous God and a Savior. There is no one besides me. Turn to me and be saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God and there is no other. By myself I have sworn, from my mouth has gone forth in righteousness a word that shall not return. To me every knee shall bow, every tongue shall swear. Only in the Lord, it shall be said of me, are righteousness and strength. All who were incensed against him shall come to him and be ashamed. In the Lord, all the offspring of Israel shall triumph and glory. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
My God, why have you forsaken me? And are so far from my cry and from the words of my distress. Oh, my God, I cry in the daytime, but you do not answer. By night as well, but I find no rest. Yet you are the Holy One, enthroned upon the praises of Israel. Our fathers put their trust in you. They trusted and you delivered them. They cried out to you and were delivered. They trusted in you and were not put to shame. But as for me, I am a worm and no man, scorned by all and despised by the people. All who see me love me to scorn. They curl their lips and wag their heads, saying, he trusted in the Lord, let him deliver him. Let him rescue him if he delights in him. Yet you are he who took me out of the womb and kept me safe upon my mother's breast. I have been entrusted to you ever since I was born. You were my God when I was still in my mother's womb. Be not far from me, for trouble is near, and there is none to help.
A reading from Paul's letter according to the Philippians. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The Passion of our Lord.
It was 2 days before the Passover, the festival of unleavened bread. The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him. For they said, not during the festival, or there may be a riot among the people.
While he was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at the table, a woman came with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment of nard. And she broke open the jar and poured the ointment on his head. But some were there who said to one another in anger, why was the ointment wasted in this way? For this ointment could have been sold for more than 300 denarii and the money given to the poor. And they scolded her.
But Jesus said, let her alone. Why do you trouble her? She has performed a good service for me. For you always have the poor with you, and you can show kindness to them whenever you wish. But you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anointed my body beforehand for its burial. Truly, I tell you, wherever the good news is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in remembrance of her.
Then Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12, went to the chief priests in order to betray him to them. When they heard it, they were greatly pleased and promised to give him money. So he began to look for an opportunity to betray them. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb was sacrificed, his disciples said to him, where do you want us to go and make the preparations for you to eat the Passover? So he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him, and wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, the teacher asks, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large room upstairs, finished and ready. Make preparations for us there. So the disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he told them. And they prepared the Passover meal.
When it was evening, he came with the 12. And when they had taken their places and were eating, Jesus said, truly, I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me. They began to be distressed and to say to him one after another, surely not I. He said to them, it is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the bowl with me. For the Son of Man goes as is written of him. But woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born.
While they were eating, he took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to them, and said, take, this is my body. And he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them, this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never drink of the fruit again until the day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God. When they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives, and Jesus said to them, you will all become deserters, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee.
Peter said to him, even though all become deserters, I will not. Jesus said to him, truly I tell you, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me 3 times. But he said vehemently, even though I must die with you, I will not deny you. And all of them said the same.
They went to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, sit here while I pray. He took with him Peter and James and John and began to be distressed and agitated and said to them, I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake. And going a little further, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that, if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said, Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I want, but what you want. He came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter, Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into the time of our trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. And again he went away and prayed, saying the same word. And once more he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. He came a third time and said to them, are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough. The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up. Let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand.
Immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. And with him, there was a crowd of swords and clubs, from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, the one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard. So when he came, he went up to him at once and said, Rabbi, and kissed him. Then they laid hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who stood near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to them, have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were abandoned? Day after day, I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled. All of them deserted him and fled. A certain young man was following him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth. They caught hold of him with the linen cloth and ran off.
Then they took Jesus to the high priest and all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes of the assembly. Peter had followed him at a distance right into the courtyard of the high priest, and he was sitting with the guards, warming himself at the fire. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. For many gave false testimony against him, and their testimony did not agree. Some stood up and gave false testimony against him, saying, "We heard him say, 'I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another not made with hands.'" But even on that point, the testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus, "Have you no answer? What is that they testify against you?" But he was silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest asked him, "Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?"
Jesus said, "I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven." Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, "Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?" All of them condemned him as deserving death. Some began to spit on him, to blindfold him, and to strike him, saying to him, "Prophesy." The guards also took him over and beat him.
While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she stared at him and said, "You also were with Jesus, the man from Nazareth." He denied it, saying, "I do not know or understand what you're talking about." And he went out into the forecourt. Then the cock crowed. And the servant girl, on seeing him, began again to say to bystanders, "This man is one of them." But again, he denied it. And after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter, "Certainly you are one of them, for you are a Galilean." And he began to curse, and he swore an oath, "I do not know this man you are talking about." At that moment, the cock crowed for the second time, and Peter remembered that Jesus had said to him, "Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me 3 times." And he broke down and wept.
As soon as it was morning, the chief priest held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked of him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" He answered him, "You say so." Then the chief priest accused him of many things. Pilate again asked him again, "Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you." But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed.
Now at the festival, he used to release prisoners for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now a man called Barabbas was in prison with a rebel who had committed murder while he was arrested. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them, "Do you want me to release for you the King of the Jews?" For he realized it was out of jealousy of the chief priests who handed him over. But the chief priest urged the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again, "Then what do you wish me to do with the man that you call King of the Jews?" Then they shouted back, "Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Why, what evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Crucify him!" So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them, and after flogging Jesus, he murdered him over. Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is the governor's headquarters. And they called together the whole cohort, and they clothed him in a purple cloak. And after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him. And they began saluting him. Hail, King of the Jews! They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down in homage. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him.
They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place they called Golgotha, which means the place of a skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each of them should do.
It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying, "Aha! You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days have saved yourself, and come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, who also mocked him among themselves and saying, "He saved others, he cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe." Those who were crucified with him also taunted him.
When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "Listen, he is calling for Elijah." And someone ran, filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink, saying, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down." Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now, when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, "Truly, this man was God's son."
There were also women looking on from a distance, among them was Mary Magdalene and Mary, mother of James, the younger, and of Joseph and Salome. These used to follow him and provided for him when he was in Galilee. There were many other women who had come up with him.
When evening had come, and since it was the day of preparation, that is, the day of the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council, who was also himself waited expectantly for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate wondered if he were already dead, and summoning the centurion, he asked him whether he had been dead for some time. When he learned from the centurion that he was dead, he granted the body to Joseph. Then Joseph brought a linen cloth, and taking down the body, wrapped it in the linen cloth, and laid it in the tomb that had been hewn up in the rock. Then he rolled a stone against the door of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, said, saw the body that was where the body was laid.
The Gospel of the Lord.
In the name of God, who loves, who is loved. But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed. When was the last time that you were amazed? Maybe you saw a rare bird or a rare flower just in blossom when you were walking outside. Maybe you heard a piece of music, or you saw a painting, or read a poem that just stopped you right in your tracks. Maybe it was the news that you were going to become a parent or a grandparent, or maybe the first time you were able to embrace a new member of your family. God's people. And when have you been amazed by God? I'm reminded of today, of Palm Sunday 5 years ago. I was in Manhattan celebrating at St. Mark's on the Bowery. And at the end of the service, I was given an armful of palms and I stashed them in my backpack. Over my shoulders, walking around, palms hanging out like this. And I went to get a hot dog. And while I walked in there, there was a whole bunch of people there who were also there to offer my hot dogs. And they saw my palms and they reacted. They said, "Oh no, it's Palm Sunday. I forgot and I don't have a way to get a palm." And I said, "Here, take a palm." So there I was, handing out palms to strangers in a hot dog restaurant. It's amazing to me that the Spirit would guide me to share a bit of the gospel with people in that way. And it reminds me that our life in Christ does not end when we step out of the doors of the church or log off Zoom after the dismissal. We see a lot of amazement today in the Passion Gospel. One of the things that you know about the Gospel of Mark, there's this feeling of immediacy. It says things happen immediately. And if you actually read this portion that we read today in the original Greek, you'd be shocked because almost every sentence starts with "and." And then this happened, and then this happened, and then this happened. So you get a sense of how excited, how amazed he is to be telling you this story we just read. We see that Jesus' disciples are amazed when Jesus says, "You're going to betray me," when they say, "Surely not I," or "Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you." We see amazement, the high priest, when he hears Jesus speak, he tears his clothes. And he's just so amazed by this. And not long after that, the curtain in the temple is also torn. In fact, we see a guy who's so surprised by what's going on, he runs off naked, which is just, that is a detail that only Mark tells. So this is an amazing narrative that we're being given today. We're amazed. Peter is amazed at his own actions. We, as the people reading the scripture, are amazed that Jesus' steadfast follower, Peter, denies him. This is shocking. And then the centurion also sees an amazing thing and has an amazing reaction to it, too. Throughout Mark, there's this recurring pattern where Jesus does something significant, heals somebody, tells somebody something about himself. And then somebody says in response, "You are the Messiah." And Jesus orders them, "Don't tell anyone else." So it's really peculiar that having died, this man who was a pagan and a Roman soldier sees Jesus and announces, "Truly, this man was God's son," naming Jesus for who Jesus truly was. At the same time in this account, though, we have this amazement, but we also have people just sort of going about their daily lives, doing what they think is a perfectly reasonable response to what's going on in the world. We have Pilate and the soldiers, and even the priests and the scribes are trying to do what they can to work toward a stable government. In fact, even Barabbas and the insurrectionists who are crucified with Jesus arguably are doing what they think is their rational duty in the face of this imperial conqueror to violently resist. We know from the resurrection in Mark that Mary Magdalene is directed to tell Peter, poor, hapless Peter, who denied his relationship with the Son of God, that Jesus is risen and has already gone on ahead of them to Galilee. And they are going to meet. At some point, this happens. We know because we're standing here today. And by the beginning of the Acts of the Apostles, we read Peter is praying and studying with Jesus's mother and publicly preaching the good news of the resurrection. In other words, the very shape of Peter's life has been radically changed by his encounter with Jesus, even though he denied him. But what about the centurion? What happens to him? Well, surely his life is so transformed by this experience. He becomes a devout follower of Jesus, right? And so for thousands of years, there's been a folk tradition around this. He's given a name, Longinus, and a medieval origin story about how Jesus's blood healed his blindness, and he became a martyr. And even in our modern popular culture, he's appeared in video games, comic books, and TV shows as a vampire or an immortal disciple of Jesus. John Wayne even played him in a movie. But none of that is in Mark. And if we put aside the John Wayne and the vampire camp and look at what Mark actually wrote down, we see what actually happens to the centurion. It's right there, and it's quite frankly amazing. Pilate wondered if Jesus were already dead, and summoning the centurion, he asked him whether he had been dead for some time. When he learned from the centurion that he was dead, he granted the body to Joseph. That's right. This man who believed he had just witnessed the death of a divine being goes back to work. He just goes back to his job and does his job. Now, I suppose the reason we've told so many stories about this man being a martyr and a vampire, because that's actually easier to believe than what the story actually tells us. Imagine being at your job and seeing God face to face at the water pool. And there, God performs a miracle right then and there in front of you. And your reaction is to go to the break room, pour yourself a cup of coffee, return to your desk, and keep filing those TPS reports. Now, I realize it's probably more complicated than that for an officer to desert the world's most powerful army. Fair enough. But if he was that amazed by God, why wasn't he willing to risk everything? In our lesson from Isaiah today, God reminds us, there is no other God besides me, a righteous God and a savior. There is no one besides me. Turn to me and be saved, all the ends of the earth. For I am God, and there is no other. To me, every knee shall bow, every tongue shall swear, only in the Lord it shall be said of me, our righteousness and strength. We are reminded of the amazing, unknowable mercy and greatness of our God. In our epistle, on the other hand, we are also amazed, but we're amazed to hear how God, for the love of us, became human. And not just human, but like a human who is enslaved and then died an agonizing, painful, cruel public execution for a crime of which he was innocent. This God shocks his hearers by crying out in solidarity with the suffering on the cross. My God, why have you abandoned me? My friends, I find that more amazing than the creation of the stars. And it compels my heart to sing, he is Lord. He is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. This amazing God we remember today, riding to conquer the world, not on a war horse, but a borrowed donkey, glorified not by troops and trumpets, but the cries of random, ordinary people who were amazed by him. I think as we get older, our threshold for wonder sometimes lowers a bit. I have many pictures of opening big pink plastic earrings on Christmas morning in the 1980s that make me look like I was just handed a box of actual magical implements, or at least maybe a box of kittens. And I'm still pretty animated, but I don't think that I would get that amazed about pink plastic earrings, even if I really like them these days. I think that's especially true in our culture. But we're so used to quantifying the world, to reducing our understanding to data and verifiable claims. And I don't mean to suggest that there's anything wrong with the scientific method, or wanting to know all we can about this world that God has created. If you are a person with a passion for astronomy, it makes sense to study the cycles our sun goes through. If you are a person with a passion for cognitive science, it makes sense to understand how humans perceive sunlight and how it provokes an emotional response in the people who see it. But I suspect that if I did those things for a living, and I happen to find myself in Maui near Mount Haleakala around sunset, I wouldn't think, oh, I do this all week long. Why bother to spend my weekend looking at the sun and enjoying it? I would go and I would be amazed by its beauty. I think sometimes it's easy to falling into the idea that our Christian life is about making our world smaller, about taking things away. I think having a season like Lent, which tends to nudge us towards ascetic practices, might reinforce that idea. We think we shouldn't do this or that, it's a sin. But remember, Lent is a season, not the whole year. And there's nothing in the practice of observing a Lenten discipline that requires us to give up anything. We are free to embrace life fully. In fact, that is even the point of letting go of things so that we can let other more beautiful things in. We stand here today on the cusp of recalling our Lord's death and resurrection. And Easter will come and Easter will go just like it does every year. We can be like the centurion, absolutely shaken to our core with amazement on Friday afternoon or Sunday morning. But by the time Monday rolls around, we're back at our desk, the same as ever. As we enter this week, I invite you to do so with the heart of Peter and Mary Magdalene, amazed and stumbling, but ready to be knocked out of our complacency and see the new thing God is doing in the world and in each of us. Look for the amazing things God is doing and the beauty of God's amazing nature. Notice them, make them a part of yourself. I invite you to be amazed by our God today and each day of our life. Amen. Amen.
Let us affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people are Form 3. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church.
That we all may be one.
Grant that every member of your church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble, especially them falling.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
We remember our friend Barb Curley on this, the 7th anniversary of her death. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
For Missy Chris's mother.
Almighty God, you know the needs of your church in every place. Look graciously upon us, the people of the Church of Redeemer, and grant us the guidance of your Holy Spirit as we seek a new rector for this parish. Give us discernment, wisdom, and confidence in your title. Guide the members of our search committee as they labor to be faithful in seeking your will. We pray for the life of our parish, that we may continue to be strengthened in our mission to be Jesus Christ's heart, hands, and feet to our neighbors, no matter where they are on their journey of faith. Bless us with mutual trust and respect, courage, and foresight as you shepherd our community through its journey. All this we ask as we walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Amen.
O Lord our God, accept the prayers of your people, and the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all the churches of the For you are gracious, the lover of souls, and the union with your glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
My sisters and brothers and siblings, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
God's peace, everybody.
God's peace, everybody.
Peace.
God's peace.
God's peace.
God's peace.
God's peace. God's peace.
Peace to everyone.
God's peace.
Peace to everyone.
God's peace.
God's peace.
God's peace.
Well, it's certainly nice to see all your faces popping up on the screen. For those of you who are visiting us today, my name is Catherine Munns. Today is Palm Sunday, and we are the Church of the Redeemer, and we're very glad that you have joined us. I have a few announcements to make, and one is I want to thank our little team of gospel readers and our door openers and our smoke wavers and certainly our IT team for being able to make Palm Sunday available to you both outside and inside the church. And I hope you all enjoyed a short walk up the aisle with us this morning. This coming week is Holy Week, as you know. And on our next time that we are able to be together is on Thursday. And Thursday evening, we will be having a service of Tenebrae. And the service of Tenebrae is about losing the light of Christ. And Nick starts off well lit, and then we have readings and songs, and slowly the lights come down and the candles go out. And it's quite a dramatic service if you've not been to one. I think you'll find it rather enjoyable. Afterward, the Altar Guild will be in here, and they are going to be taking things out of church and preparing it for the empty tomb. And all evening long, all night from 9 p.m. until 10 o'clock the next morning, which is Good Friday morning, we will be able to check in on Zoom and sit for an hour here in the church on Zoom in the quietness. In the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus says to the disciples, "Can you not just stay awake with me for 1 hour?" And that is what this practice is based on. Can you stay awake with Christ for 1 hour on the eve of his death? And so I invite you to come and, on the Zoom and contemplate that with us. There's a place to sign up, but on the sign up genius that was sent out. But even if you haven't signed up on the sign up genius, you're certainly welcome to come in here Thursday evening via Zoom and be a part of this meditation time. Then on Friday, Good Friday morning at 10 a.m., we will be having a virtual Stations of the Cross. And Erin is still looking for some readers for that. So if you would like to volunteer, she would like to hear from you. She is stepping in right now and scheduling through Easter for us. And she could certainly use some help. And then on Friday evening, Good Friday evening, we'll have our traditional Good Friday service, and it too will be virtual. Saturday is the day of preparation for the Great Vigil of Easter. And you are invited to the Great Vigil of Easter, which is the most historic service in the Christian church. And I invite you to be a part of that. And I'm going to tell you a story about it that night. And it will start at 8 p.m. as the sun goes down, and we light the new fire of Easter and chant our way through that service and salvation history until we get to the resurrection. And then, of course, on Easter Sunday, sorry about my voice, it's an allergy morning. Easter Sunday morning at 10:30, we will have our regular Easter service. Now, you may have gotten the one reading that said, or the one missive that said 10 o'clock. Forget that. It was a historical error on my part. It's at 10:30, Redeemer time. So that will be Easter Sunday. And there are, in the last newsletter, possibilities for you to donate Easter flowers if you so choose. That is it for announcements, I believe. And I would like to mention that we have some poems left over. There's a stack of them right here. And I have some already consecrated wafers that you may pick up from the church on Tuesday, Wednesday, or Thursday during office hours. And you can you can receive communion with us on either Saturday night or Easter Sunday morning. And that's all I have for announcements. Erin has one.
So I know we talked about readers for the Stations of the Cross. We also need readers for the Easter Vigil service at 8 p.m. on Saturday. So if you are interested in reading for that service, I promise you won't have a chance. I'll send you the reading in advance. You can actually sign up, Jeannie, you can pick your reading. So if you're interested, if you're planning on coming to that service, I think you should discern a call to whether you're called to read that service too. So thank you.
Now let us with gladness present the offerings of our life and our labor and our love to the Lord.
Right.
is wrong with false and scattered garments strewn.
Ride on in majesty, in holy pomp, ride on to die. O Christ, thy triumphs now begin, o'er captive death and conquered sin.
Our service of worship continues with a great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, for our sins he was lifted high upon the cross, that he might draw the whole world to himself. By his suffering and death, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who put their trust in him. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord.
give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation. The calling of Israel be your people, and your word spoken through the prophets. And above all, the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you brought us out of error into the truth, out of sin and the righteousness, out of death and the life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. And if you drink this, do it in remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father,
we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory.
And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country wherewith all your saints you may enter the everlasting inheritance of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. God, human, wisdom, and nature, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Mercy on us, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace.
My Jesus, I believe that you are truly present in the blessed sacrament of the altar. I love you above all things and long for you in my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart, as though you have already come. I embrace you and unite myself entirely to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Eternal God,
Heavenly Father,
you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food, the sacrament of the body of love. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you, with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you now and remain with you always.
Amen.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ.
Thanks be to God.